When I first met the movement, I had been ordained about 10 years. And I would say that in some respects, my career as a priest was sort of at a high point. So I began my priesthood serving as an assistant professor at Providence College. I was a professor of theater arts. And then was assigned to kind of a strange apostolate in Los Angeles as the director of creative affairs for a Catholic film company called Paulus Productions. And after that, I served briefly in a parish and then was called here to New York City. And I worked down at New York University where I was the director of campus ministry for the Catholic Center. And then Cardinal O'Connor, of happy memory, wanted a Dominican to teach preaching at the major seminary in Yonkers in Woody. And so he asked me if I would do that. So I went and began, and then after a while, gave up the job at NYU and was full-time at Dunwoody teaching preaching. So it was, from a certain perspective, a very wonderful priesthood filled with a lot of, if you want to use this word, success. But I have to tell you something. I didn't feel successful, and what I felt was a little sad, because there was a loneliness in my life, which I didn't understand. Because when you look at all of those factors, a certain logic, which I learned is unreliable, tells you, well, those kinds of successes should add up to a sense of fulfillment. But it didn't happen. So I thought there was something wrong with me. I still think there's something wrong with me, but I thought there was something wrong with me for that. And so I was looking for something more. And I really couldn't put my finger on it, but the reality is I was looking for Christ. So I think as Father Giussani says, I think I was beginning to forget him. And what compounded that was that I was very dismayed by the fact that the other people in my life didn't seem to be going through the same turmoil. Why weren't they looking for something more? Why weren't they experiencing this sense of loss, or even at times of a kind of an anguish? Why wasn't there this thirst, as Father Giussani suddenly talks about the religious senses, but thirst for happiness and goodness and beauty? Not to pass judgment, but I sensed in the lives of the people who surrounded me, there was not this drive and a sense of kind of settling towards that. So I began to wonder then if I was just being selfish, or if there was just something so disordered with me that I simply needed maybe to go see a therapist or something. And at that moment, Christ, in his great wisdom and love and mercy, put someone in my life. It was one of my students, a seminarian, who had to, in our preaching class, stand up and give a practice homily. And usually, this stage in priestly training and in learning how to preach, the homilies are not so good, for very, you would say, explainable reasons. There's no blame there. This homily was astonishing, and not simply because it was rhetorically very sound, intellectually very astute, etc. But there was something about it that couldn't be explained away using any of those reasons. And so when the class was over, I asked him, how are you able to do this? And he said immediately, without any hesitation, I follow the movement, Communion and Liberation, the charism of Father Giussani, and what you heard is the life that I'm following, the life I'm living. So I said, please, I need to learn about this too, because it was what I was looking for. What he said at that, not just the words, but the way he said it, brought forth this presence. It was wonderful. And I thought, well, maybe just this one astonishing young man, because he is quite extraordinary. But then he introduced me to a poet. And being of an artistic background, I had a great interest in people like this, who, again, in terms of our human virtues, were quite astonishing, but there was something beyond that. And even the first poem she read to me, there was this other there, this Christ who I was missing. I thought, well, okay, that's only two, maybe. So then I was introduced to a musician, and the same beautiful face appeared, the face of Christ. So with that, I was kind of hooked and went to a vacation of human liberation, and then experienced this wondrous beauty of Christ as it was lived in the oneness of these people together. And what was so astonishing about it is that, if you know anybody from human liberation, that there are not two people that are alike. Human liberation people, CL people, are not cookie-cutter Catholics in any way. So to be in a place with people who are so distinctive in terms of their personalities, so normal, which is not always something you're going to find when you get a bunch of Catholics together, and so full of gladness and certainty, etc., it was, for me, a kind of a miracle, and it meant that I had to obey. I had to begin to follow and learn and unite myself to the way that Christ had answered my begging for him to come into my life and to take care of the sadness, which he did. He lifted it. So that is how I met the movement. And it has changed the way that I've lived my priesthood. So I don't teach preaching the way I used to teach it in those days. I teach it differently. In fact, I even wrote a book about how to preach based on the method that I learned from community liberation and reading Luigi Giussani. The way that I live in community with my Dominican brothers has been changed because of community liberation. The way that I face my problems, which have not decreased but increased since joining community liberation. And I thank God for every one of them because of the wonderful face that is always there to take me through whatever it is that wants to lead me off this path. So we can ask the question, is community liberation relevant for the church at this moment in the United States of America? Because when we look at that film, we see how relevant it is for Italy, but what about for the here and now? And I have to say, with all of my heart, absolutely it is. Not simply because, if I've ever read a doctor of the church, Monsignor Luigi Giussani is that. I don't know that he'll ever be proclaimed that, but in my judgment, he is that. And that's how I revere his writing. So not simply for that reason, which is a very important reason. But as Father Giussani said after he left that assembly, when the reporters said to him sort of flippantly, what were all of these people waiting for? And he said, you know, why were they waiting for you? And he said, because I believe in what I say. I mean, have you ever met a person like that in your entire life? I have very rarely, but I have in the movement. And it's exactly what the beating heart of the Catholic Church in the United States of America is dying for right now, is to meet a Catholic who believes in what he or she says. For person believes it. As St. Thomas More says in the movie Man for All Seasons, he says, I believe, he says, no, I believe that we believe in something, first of all, fearlessly, without looking at Christ and being ashamed of him, without forgetting him, and speaking from that conviction. If there is a Catholic who stands up in front of us as that kind of a witness, it's really all these aching human hearts need, because of the terrible, abysmal lack of belief in whatever arena of life that you want to visit. I'm not talking simply about Christian belief. I mean, belief in anything, conviction, certainty about anything is very rare. And the reason it's rare is because the moment a person starts to speak with certainty, they're hated. As the movie makes very clear that Giussani was opposed. Why was he opposed? Is that because of his sanguine disposition? Maybe, but because he spoke with so much certainty. As the one person said, I hated him too when he spoke the truth, because no one likes to have the truth put in front of them. But without that truth, without that certainty, we wilt. And this, it seems to me, is one of the great blessings of the charism of Siena, the ability to speak the truth in a way that is not dogmatic in the worst sense of that word. Why did Monsignor Giussani, why was he so moved to begin this friendship, which is communal liberation? Because he saw the solidarity, as he called it, of communists. And he looked at them and was struck by that and said, baptized Christians have a greater right to that kind of unity than communists have any day. And it's Christ's gift to us. And it's in that solidarity, it's in that unity, that this certainty thrives. And all we have to do is look at the original church to see how much the presence of the Christians as they were gathered in Solomon's portico stopped people in their tracks, so that they nudged each other and said, what is going on down there? I mean, it's old people, it's young people, it's different races, it's people who are educated, people who are uneducated, people that haven't had a bath in 3 weeks, people that are dressed to the nines. How could so many people be put together? What is it that could possibly be uniting them? But it's the unity that drew them off the path to go down there to ask. I think also, obviously, it's what Monsignor Giussani understood so well about how Christianity has to be proposed. So, as the movie makes clear, it doesn't begin with doctrine. It begins with my needs, with my desires. When's the last time in your life anyone ever asked about your life or wanted to be involved in your life, starting from the vantage point of what you needed most? That almost never happens to me. But when it happens, things change. Just knowing that there is someone who has an attentiveness to my thirst for beauty, for goodness, for justice, as he says. Just knowing that there is someone who is mindful of the fact that the only way for me to make sense of life is by judging whatever is put in front of me according to my need for beauty and goodness. And that, as Father Giussani says, that amazingly, these things don't go away. Yeah, they be put to sleep, but they don't go away. Well, the church exists precisely for this purpose, to educate people to the religious sense. And the movement has caught on to this original intuition of our Christ and has been doing that for now several decades, but is poised to do it in an exceptional way at this moment in time when the Holy Father is calling for a new evangelization. In what form is that new evangelization going to take? It's a problem. It's a problem. And in fact, the next synod of the church is going to be dedicated to the new evangelization. And I think one of the reasons why the Holy Father has convened such a synod is because he knows we really don't know how to talk about this thing. But one thing I know for sure, as the Holy Father says in Sacramentum Caritatis, and then again repeating the very same words in Verbum Domini, speaking about preaching, He says that homilies are too generic and abstract. Now, I know how much you love those homilies, but they're coming to an end. I have to warn you that they're coming to an end. And what changes that terrible experience of generic and abstract preaching? But what beauty? A beauty that takes the form not of an idea, but of a friendship, but of a face. And human liberation is simply that. I mean, if this film proves anything, it is that. I've seen it probably 20 times now, 4 times just this week. And I can keep seeing again and again the scene of the two missionaries going off to Brazil, because there's something just so extraordinary about that friendship that can't be faked. It's Christ. Only Christ can make that happen. So it's not a surprise then that the Holy Father, when he became the Pope, made one of his priorities as the Supreme Pontiff to reduce the bureaucracy of the Vatican, and yet, astonishingly, he just created a new council, which is the Pontifical Council for the New Evangelization. As I started to say, it's not surprising to me that one of the consultants to that council is our own Father Julian Caron, because the Holy Father, I think, understands and appreciates in a way that is very unique, as the film makes out, just what kind of contribution human liberation can make to this project of the new evangelization, and why it's right and fitting that we rely on it. So if you're intrigued by what you've seen about CL, I encourage you to find out more about it. It will only make your life, even if it's very happy, much happier. And if not, you get your money back. I'd be happy to hear take any questions or hear any comments that you'd like to make. Yes? So the first question is about passion. It's a great question. And you see how the sister answered it. So she said, Father Giussani didn't propose Jesus Christ to us. He proposed happiness. Well, that sounds sort of theoretical or scandalous or something. Now, my order is the one that had the Inquisition, so you know, you're careful about those kinds of things. But he's right. Because Father Giussani understood, if I propose Christ to you, and Christ is the answer, but you're not living the question that for which Christ is the answer, but that's a great definition of boring. You know, it's boring. So he preaches happiness, which is that passion. So to live this passion, I dare to live my humanity. I dare to look at myself just as I did after those 10 years of, you know, sort of bleakness in my priesthood and say, I want something more. You know, I need something more. I need more goodness. I need more beauty. I need to know truth more. I don't want to live just sort of, I don't want to get by. I want to live with a kind of intensity because my heart won't rest until it does. But what happens is when our heart flares up like that, and we are alone, and we don't have the face of Christ with us, which is the reason why the church exists, then I think that I'm having a heart attack, you know? So I do something, I don't know, I have to get a bypass or whatever it is, but I mean, I should try to shut my heart down. But when I have somebody who makes my heart come alive like that, then yes, Jesus Christ is everything for me, and I can't help but to be a witness to that, but to everyone else. Your question about scripture, I think, would make Father Giussani extremely happy. Because if you look, you know, he has three very important books, The Religious Sense, At the Origin of the Christian Claim, and Why the Church. And if you look in the second volume, At the Origin of the Christian Claim, which in some ways is my favorite, because it's about Jesus. In the early pages, I should know the page, but I don't. He tells us how to read the Bible. He says, what people don't realize is this. What's in the Bible, especially the gospel, is something that someone remembered. It's a memory. And there's a reason why this memory was written down. There's thousands of things that our Lord did, right? They don't make it into the Bible. Why? They lost those pages. No, that's not why. Because this is the memory. This is the event that was changing the evangelist's life. And he wrote it down and he says, everything in the Bible is an announcement. An announcement of an event. So I have to read it that way. And I think, well, I have no proof of this, but I'm willing to, you know, put my money, which I have a little of, on the line and say, why did the Holy Father in the last synod have a synod about the Word of God? And then subsequently published the post-synodal Apostolic Exhortation Verbum Domini. Because in that papal document, he's teaching us how to read the Bible, and he's saying all these very same things, as Father Giussani said, and more. So that's how we do it, by taking up these texts. When you read the Bible, pretend it's a person. That's all you have to do. Pretend it's a person. And what would you do with this person in front of you? You never try to memorize your friends, right? I mean, it would be kind of a rude thing to do. I don't want to be memorized. I want to be gazed at anew. I want to be listened to anew, and I want to listen to you. I want to have an exchange. I could talk about this for 10 hours, but I love you too much to do it, so I won't. We need 15 seconds, because that's what you're supposed to do in the classroom.